Welcome, my friends. You're listening to the voice of the Eternal Gospel, a program brought to you by the Eternal Gospel Ministry, founded in 1992 by Seventh-day Adventist believers. This is a Christian program dedicated to bring you the prophetic fulfillment, warning, and revelations of the end times, and to promote the advancement of Christ in your life.
Welcome, my friends, again to the voice of the Eternal Gospel. We're going to continue today studying about these great messages, great prophetic truth for this end time. Before we do that, let's have a word of prayer. Let's pray, please.
Father in heaven, again we bow before thee, seeking wisdom from on high. For you said, if any man lack wisdom, let him ask of God, who giveth liberty and abrideth not. We ask for wisdom, knowledge, and understanding as we search the scriptures on Revelation, especially here on the Church of Pergamos. Father, we ask that you will please guide us by your Holy Spirit, who guides into all truth and who brings all things to our remembrance. And Father, we thank you for hearing our prayer, and we address our prayer to the most holy place of the heavenly sanctuary. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Amen. We started the last program studying, looking at into the church of Pergamos. The Bible describes chapter 2 of Revelation, verse 13, 12, and 13. And we noticed that that church, there was some, it's called in the Bible, a compromising church. And just to refresh, few seconds, Brother Patrick, why was a compromising church again?
Well, the previous church of Smyrna was where the pagan Rome was trying to eliminate it through force and persecution, putting them to death, burning them at the stake, and throwing them to the lions in that way. But Satan saw that that wasn't working. Someone said that the blood of the Christians was seed, and the more they did that, the more people were converted. Right. So he decided another ploy, and that was to bring the world into the church. And Constantine became converted in 313 AD, and now the church was being united with the Roman government, and there was compromising of doctrines, because when the church is united to the state, doctrines get lowered and lowered to allow sin to march in.
Okay, during that time, okay, why don't we read the next verse over there, chapter 2, verse 14, 15, because there were some doctrines that were being already introducing then, creeping in into Christianity right around that time. And Revelation chapter 2, verse 14 and 15 speaks about that. Can you read it, please, Brother Patrick?
But I have a few things against thee, because thou hast there them that hold the doctrine of Balaam, who taught Balak to cast a stumbling block before the children of Israel, to eat things sacrificed unto idols, and to commit fornication. So hast thou also them that hold the doctrine of the Nicolaitans, which things I hate.
Right. And there was a counsel that Jesus was giving to the Christians of that time, to the one that wanted to remain faithful. And that is found on verse 13, the same chapter.
13, I know thy works and where thou dwellest, even where Satan's seat is, and thou holdest fast my name and hast not denied my faith, even in those days wherein Antipas was my faithful martyr, who was slain among you where Satan dwelleth.
I know there's so many things in here, Pastor Brady. You have to help us.
Well, as we're looking at this issue, notice very carefully here in Revelation chapter 2, and looking at that verse, what we're dealing with here about the church of Pergamos. Mm-hmm. Notice it says where Satan's seat is. Mm-hmm. I want to go there for a minute. What is Satan's seat? You know, you hear people say Satan's seat, but what is his seat? What does Satan himself aspire to be? And then we can see very clearly that Satan's seat is connected to the mystery of iniquity. How do we know? In Isaiah chapter 14, verses 12 through 14, we read, in Isaiah it says there, how art thou fallen from heaven, O Lucifer, son of the morning? How art thou cut down to the ground for the weakened nations? For thou hast said in thy heart, I will ascend into heaven. I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. I will sit also on the mount of the congregation, the sides of the north. I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. I will be like the Most High. Satan's desire was to be like the Most High. So wait a minute. What is his seat? Go with me to Ezekiel chapter 28, verse 2. Can you read it for me, Patrick?
28, verse 2. Mm-hmm. Son of man, say unto the prince of Tyrus, thus saith the Lord God, because thine heart is lifted up, and thou hast said, I am God. I sit in the seat of God, in the midst of the seas. Yet thou art a man and not God, though thou set thine heart as the heart of God.
Under the pagan Roman Empire, the emperors began to deify themselves as gods. Lucifer's desire was he wanted to be like God in power. So humanity, in his sinful state, has also sought, men who have ruled over other men especially, have sought to sit themselves in the place as God among the people. And so Satan's seat is a man making himself to be God. In fact, we find that this is made out more clear when you read this, Revelation chapter 2. Look very carefully here. When it says here, what Satan doeth, Satan's seat is, and thou holdest fast my name, and hast not denied my faith in the days of Antipas, my faithful martyr. Now, who is Antipas? And you're going to see how I say Antipas is connected to Satan's seat. The word anti means against. Pas means against Papa, or against Pope. Who? What? Antipas? Antipas was a faithful martyr. We can know that. But Antipas represents those who were against the bishop of Rome, who was now exalting himself through bringing paganism and Christianity together. Mm-hmm. And as a result, we find here that Antipas means against Papa or against the Pope or the overseer or the church at that time, which was the bishops of Rome at that point. This is also showing that this compromise will result in this man, a man making himself to be God. We have a wonderful, in Jude, in the book of John, 3 John, I mean, and I think that's John, 2 John, I want to show you a precursor to the issue of Antipas, that you can see, so you can see it better clear. In John chapter, I think it's 1 John, in 2 John, no, in 3 John, look at verse 9, and I want to show you what was going to happen. Notice the characteristics here. He says, I write unto the church, but Theophilus, who loved to have what?
The preeminence.
Preeminence among them. Satan's seed is a man making himself to be God, but a man who loves to have what? Preeminence among his fellow man. Not equal to his brethren, but wants to be exalted above his brethren. Mm. It says here, among them received us not. Wherefore, when I come, I will remember his deeds, which he doeth, prating against us with malicious words, and not content therewith, neither doeth himself receive the brethren. And watch this, and forbiddeth them that would, and would cast, and cast them out of the church. This is Satan's seat. When men love to have preeminence, when a man makes himself to be God. And in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verses 3 and 4, read that for us. And then
then in relationship with what my brother Patrick is going to read, 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, because God gave a warning to the church.
That's right.
Through Paul.
Through Paul.
That before Jesus will come back, there will be a system.
That's right.
A compromising sector of Christianity.
A system that would blend paganism and Christianity together, which is Satan's masterpiece of deception.
Right. Can you read, Brother Patrick? And then, please, Pastor Barry, you can read much better than I do in the English language, so you can read this, because we need to prove
that a man has exalted himself as God. Right. Yeah, okay.
What the Bible was predicting, it's been happening, it's taking place. So our friends out there will say, wow, you know, what these people are bringing out to us, I can see it, I can testify, history testify, and thus the Word of God is indeed the Word of God. Can you read the description, the prediction that the Bible, Paul was making in relationship to this power? Because during this compromising church period, that's when this religious power was coming up.
2 Thessalonians 2, 3 and 4.
Right.
Let no man deceive you by any means, for that day shall not come except there come a falling away first, and that the man of sin be revealed, the son of perdition, who opposeth and exalteth himself above all that is called God or that is worshipped, so that he is God, sitteth in the temple of God, showing himself that he is God.
So Paul was predicting that there'll be coming a man, individual, a man, not a woman, not an animal, not a supernatural being coming out of some part of another galaxy.
Right.
But a man exalting himself, pretending that he would be like God on earth. Now, the question that we have to ask, can we find in the history, with an open mind, we put all the religious prejudice aside, can we read in history, institution, or a man pretending to be man, to be God on this earth? Can you read it, please?
Yes.
And we'll give the sources.
All right. It says here, Pope Leo the 23rd wrote in an encyclical letter to the whole church, the supreme teacher in the church is the Roman pontiff. Union of minds therefore requires, together with a perfect accord in the one faith, complete submission and obedience of the will to the church and to the Roman pontiff as to God himself. The same pope further declared in an encyclical letter dated June 20th, 1892, we hold upon this earth the place of God Almighty. We shall quote from another Roman Catholic authorized work to show how this man, of which Paul speaks, exalts himself. The pope is of so great dignity and so exalted that he is not a mere man, but as it were God and the vicar of God. The pope is crowned with a triple crown as king of heaven and of earth and of the lower regions. This is from Professor P.F. Lucius Ferres, Ecclesiastical Dictionary, article Pope.
So all these are Roman Catholic sources and a statement from Pope.
Yes.
Leo 13.
Go ahead. I'd like to share with you one more point, and that was to show that historically, when we said that the popes were the bishops of Rome were gathering power in Rome at this time, in this book is Catholics and Protestants, What Catholics and Protestants Should Know, it says here, paganism and, what was it that still held back the man, talking about the man of sin to coming, it says from exercising his full power, paganism and Caesars at Rome were still too strong for him. Paganism had to be taken out of the way first. This was done gradually until the Caesars turned their power and the city of Rome over to the Pope. He became the head of state as well as of the church. Paganism and Christianity were united and modern Catholicism was developed.
Wow, what a perfect fulfillment of prophecy. I don't think that nobody will deny that has a little bit of knowledge of history that this exactly is what is taking place today. I know this is such an important topic and it's very, it's not politically correct, let's say that. But because of that, we need to, we will continue. We'll pick up on this and we will be right back.
Paul and Jesus both predict that the Church of God becomes a force against God.
The radical faith that Jesus taught had become the official religion of the empire that murdered him.
The speed with which the early church tobogganed into apostasy will take your breath away.
Welcome back. All right, let's, I know that this is, we just were saying that we see to the very letter fulfillment of one of the most clear prophecy in the Bible about, what we're talking about, this period of the church the day started, began compromising. Again, to the argument that I have heard in previous institutions that I used to attend is that it was so good that time because we were trying to make out of pagan Christianity. And the devil was actually doing the opposite. No wonder the reproof come right here from Jesus. He says, I got a few things against you. Talk about the Christian people at that time. They had the doctrine of Balaam either. Okay, so let's take a couple of minutes about the doctrine of Balaam. We know he was a false prophet. Yes, I'm sorry, you were going to say something.
Balaam would represent the church. And he taught Balak to cast a stumbling block before the children of Israel. And Balak he was the king of Moab in the Old Testament, but he would represent the state.
Right.
And so it shows a union of church and state, and he would teach to commit fornication. And the church should always be married to Jesus, but the church that fornicates we just read this in Revelation 17, verse 1, where it says, verse 2, that the church...
Or the woman
with whom the kings of the earth have committed fornication.
And fornication, of course, means union, unity, you know.
Yeah. And one of the things that happened in history, not way in the future, but that's the Catholic ploy to get the finger of the Bible off them, putting things way in the future. This happened in history where the Pope claimed to have two swords. Mm. He had power over ecclesiastical matters,
right,
and power over civil matters, the state. Right. Church power and civil power over everyone on planet Earth. Mm. And people believed that, went along with it, and this was an exaltation of the Bishop of Rome at that time.
So the doctrine of Balaam that was already seen openly during that period of time, yeah, when the papacy was arising, coming out, the first pope began at that time, after the third century.
Right.
Because Peter was not the first pope. Mm. I mean, I hope our friends out there, I mean, that's not, I mean, that should be prophecy 101. I mean, there was no such a thing as Peter being the first pope.
The time of Pergamos is the same time that we see in Revelation 13, verse 1, where the beast is rising up, where the papal Rome. Verse 2 says, the dragon gave him, the dragon representing pagan Rome, mm-hmm, the dragon gave him, papal Rome, his power, his seat, and great authority. His seat, his capital, Rome. That's why the papacy today is called what? The Holy See.
Right.
His seat. This time is also the same time, the Pergamos period is the same time, when the clay starts mixing in with the iron in Daniel chapter 2.
Right.
The church. The clay is the church mixing in with the iron, the state of Rome.
And I think we need to clarify something. Some people might be saying, well, okay, it was those popes in the past that say, you know, he's God on earth, that they are like God on this earth. I believe that they are still holding on to those beliefs, you know, because I don't.
The issue here, what you're bringing out is an important issue that most people have forgotten, that the stance of Protestantism, because the Counter-Reformation that came into Protestantism brought up this theory that the Pope was, the Antichrist was a man that's going to rule 3.5 years in the future. But the true Protestant position on the Antichrist was that the Antichrist was one man, followed by a succession of men, understanding that in prophecy each day stands for a year. It was one man followed by a succession of men that would rule for 1,260 years.
Right.
Therefore, we can find that if we follow the true Protestant position, then one pope, which is represented by Antichrist in the century of the pagan Roman Empire as a compromise in Christianity, has come, would develop, the man of sin would develop and be followed by a succession of men, mm-hmm, all the way up to this very present day, which we can trace when you trace the history of the papacy. Mm-hmm. Now, the Bible brings out one thing that's very important. They said they had the doctrine of Balaam.
Right.
Now, what was the doctrine of Balaam? Balaam, we know, committed whoredom and brought about union of church and state. But one of the things that it says here, 2 Peter 2:15. Read 2 Peter 2:15 for me.
Right.
2:15 says,
okay,
which have forsaken the right way and gone astray, following the way of Balaam, the son of Bozar.
So God is magnifying the idea that the church of Rome, who had started off with the understanding righteousness when Paul started that church, had forsaken the right way. And in forsaking the right way, they began to love the wages of unrighteousness.
Of unrighteousness.
That's right. And unrighteousness is sin.
Right.
And therefore, under the Church of Rome, it would be in the Church of Rome centuries later that they would seek to even change God's law, Daniel 7:25.
Right.
But go with me now to Jude 11.
Yeah.
And let's
it's
read
only
again.
One chapter, right?
One chapter, Jude 11, right.
Okay. Okay.
Somebody read that one for me.
Woe unto them, for they have gone in the way of Cain and ran greedily after the error of Balaam for reward and perished in the gainsaying.
Now, way of Cain meant that God, they had their own righteousness. Cain was disgruntled with God because God did not accept his offering. And to the point, Cain offered fruit and did not offer the offering of righteousness and an animal sacrifice. The Bible foreshows that in the last days, and at the time of the Church of Pergamos, and again at the last days, there will be the church, the papal power, Catholicism, and apostate Protestantism would go the way of Cain. They would begin to offer up their own set of righteousness. They would give their own different sacrifices and ask God to accept it. And at the same time, they have forsaken the what? The right way. The Protestant churches will forsake the Bible as much as the Roman church did in the early centuries. Then the Bible says one other thing about them. They shows here that they were greedy. And so greed will become a major issue in the last days among churches. And you see a lot of prosperity churches who love money and who love large congregations, but they have forsaken the way of God. They have forsaken the way of truth. And neither will they lead their congregations to even want to hear or acknowledge to the truth. And not only that, but Balaam cursed God for money, cursed God's people for money. Balaam and Balak united to destroy Israel. Balaam and Balaam is a false prophet, as there's a false church, as Patrick brought out, and also Balak is a king of Moab, which is a state power. So the Bible foretells that the compromise between paganism and Christianity will result in the development of man of sin and the union of church and state. This is what the Church of Pergamos is bringing out. And he casts a stumbling block before the children of Israel. What's the stumbling block? What's Deuteronomy 7:25?
7:25.
That's right. They're going to cast a stumbling block. What is that stumbling block that's going to come?
Okay, do you have it, brother?
The graven image of their God shall ye burn with fire. Thou shalt not desire the silver or gold that is on them, nor take unto thee, lest thou be snared therein, for it is an abomination to the Lord thy God.
Okay, so wait a minute. A stumbling block is an abomination, and it's a sacrifice of idols. So an idol is going to be set up in the Church of Pergamos that's going to cast a stumbling block for the church from that time on up to this very day. What idol is going to be set up by Rome or by the union of church and state that's going to become a stumbling block even to this very day?
I believe it's the sacredness of Sunday. Sunday.
Yes.
The sun.
Yes. Because, but now remember, Sunday can't be set up unless the church and the state are brought together.
Right. The union.
And the union. Yeah. And this is what we see taking place in the history of Pergamos. And this same history will be seen again at the end of time. And this is the stumbling block. And Sunday is the stumbling block because it's an abomination. Go to Ezekiel chapter 8 with me. Ezekiel 8. I want to make sure you understand. Because the church is committing fornication. That's a union of church and state.
Right.
But the great stumbling block in the midst of the fornication will be an abomination. Look what it says there. Can you read it for me? Ezekiel 8, 16.
Verse 16 says, and he brought me into the inner court of the Lord's house. And behold, at the door of the temple of the Lord, between the porch and the altar, were about 25 men, with their backs toward the temple of the Lord, and their faces toward the east, and they worshiped the sun toward the east.
But now, is the sun worship a stumbling block? Because is Sunday a stumbling block? Is it an abomination? Put it that way. Because the stumbling block was the abomination. What's an abomination? Is it abomination? What did verse say?
Verse 17 says, Then he said unto me, Hast thou seen this, O son of man? Is it a light thing to the house of Judah that they commit the abominations which they commit here? So yes.
Okay. And so great. And this was the greater abomination than immortality of the soul. When we go back and read Ezekiel. So we find that Balaam and Balak came together, that's the union of church and state, and the stumbling block they would cast would be Sunday observance. Now, was there a power? Was there a power from the state that brought in historically a stumbling block for the people in early Christianity who were all Sabbath keepers at the time?
Right. Well, at the time of Constantine.
The time of Constantine. So
he united
you were talking about
with
that
the
earlier.
Bishop of Rome.
Can you go into explanation again? Give us that part again about the stumbling. The stumbling block is an idol,
right?
And the idol's abomination. Was there such a thing?
By the time of 538 A.D., Sunday worship was enforced all over the world. Mm-hmm. That's when Justinian made the decree that the Pope would be the head of all the holy churches. Justinian had wiped out three groups of people that didn't believe like the Pope. Got them out of the way, and by 538 there was no more interference from anyone. The Pope was the head of the church, and it was a kind of a new world order at that time, and that's what they're working for today, that everyone would worship the Trinity on Sunday.
And if we don't believe that, then go back to the issue of the story of Balaam and Balak. What was the stumbling block that was cast before the children of Israel on the borders of the Canaan land?
Right.
They committed whoredom,
right,
with the Moabites, correct?
Mm-hmm.
They committed fornication, but then they was led through the fornication to sacrifice to make sacrifices to the dead, and the ultimate worship of the dead was the worship of immortality of the soul, which was also going into Sunday sacredness.
Mm-hmm.
You have all that there.
So that's why the Bible described it as a compromising church.
Yes,
at that time.
Absolutely.
Yes. Five seconds.
The papacy wants to control the minds of everyone on planet Earth.
We will see in the next program how a strong message that Jesus sent for the Christians at that time. But that will be in another time. Unfortunately, our time is up. In the meantime, we want you to keep the faith of Jesus. And God bless you.
Tis a promise most cheering, but we know.
Our Voice of the Eternal Gospel family thanks you for joining us. Generous contributors like you keep us broadcasting. Prayerfully consider supporting this ministry. Donations are tax deductible and can be sent to Voice of the Eternal Gospel, P.O. Box 15138, West Palm Beach, Florida, 33416. Our phone number is 1-866-7TH-2. That's 1-866-784-3292. And our web address is voiceoftheeternalgospel.com.